So the phylum Protozoa is a very primitive phylum, okay, and it is also very diverse phylum. So the basic characteristic is what? It is a phylum, it is a group of unicellular organism. Now before I start with the first phylum, that is phylum Protozoa, I would just like to give you a brief introduction on how exactly the animal kingdom is divided. So animal kingdom is divided into different phyla. So singular is phylum, plural is phyla. So this each of the phylum, okay, is further divided into the class. Okay, class is then divided into order, and orders are then divided into families. Families are then divided into genus, and genus to species, and then subspecies, and there can be strains. Okay, so why this whole classification, or how this whole classification happens, it happens step by step. So animals are initially broadly divided into the phylums, and then very specific, with respect to very specific characteristics, they are further divided up to the species level. And what is the definition of a species? Species is a group of animal that can interbreed and then give rise to fertile offspring. Okay, so if I ask you what is species, many times students tell me that species is a group of animal that look similar or look same, or they live together, or they have similar habits. So that is all true, but that cannot be the definition of species, because there can be members in a same species which may look different. There could be a different morphology, there can be polymorphism, or there can be a species which can have individuals which have different food habits, slightly different from each other, but still they can be one species if the members of that particular group can interbreed and then give rise to a fertile offspring. If they interbreed, but the offsprings or the next generation which is being produced is not fertile, that generation cannot give rise to the next generation, then we cannot consider that those two individuals belong to same species. For example, you take example of maybe horse and donkey. So if horse and donkey breed together, there is a formation of mule. So can we say that the horse and donkey are same species? No, because mule is not fertile. Mule cannot breed with mule to make another generation of mule. So therefore, we conclude that horse and donkey are two different species. So similarly, many times there is not even formation of the next generation. Many times the breeding cannot happen, cannot be successful. In only some specific cases where two species can be slightly close to each other, the next generation can come up, but which is infertile. So I hope you understood now what is the definition of a species. Why it is important to know what is species? Because whole idea of studying the classification is basically understanding how we can put animals together. So based on different characteristics, we are putting them together with similar characteristics. But when we come to species, only the looks and the morphological characters and the embryological characters and the development is not sufficient. For being a member of a species, they must interbreed and give rise to a new generation that is going to be fertile. Okay, so let us now come back to our today's topic, that is phylum Protozoa. So Protozoa is a primitive phylum, a group which has very primitive organisms, could be the very first organisms that have got the status of maybe animal, that could be called animal, so eukaryotes. Okay, so these primitive eukaryotic organisms, which are unicellular, exclusively unicellular organisms, belong to this particular phylum. So you can see different pictures here. This one looks green, the other one has a red patch, the other few are totally transparent, maybe something is there here which can be the ingested food. So there is diversity. See here, the shape is different, here maybe that the projections are smaller, and here maybe there is something which is looking like an envelope which is present around the organism. So there is diversity. You cannot just say that protozoa are spherical or they don't have shape. any statement you make which is not going to be universal for the protozoa. There is always exception to it. Why? Because it is a diverse phylum. Now, what are the learning outcomes of this particular topic? What we are going to discuss today is at the end of this topic, okay, at the end of this lecture, you will be able to describe protozoa, okay, the morphology. Then you will be able to enlist the characteristics of protozoa as a phylum. Then you will be able to enlist at least 5 examples of protozoa. And you can also explain how protozoa reproduce. There are different ways. So let us begin. So first thing is, okay, they are eukaryotic and among animal kingdom, they are primitive. But still there is a debate that whether they are plants or they are animals. Whether they are eukaryotic unicellular animal cells or eukaryotic unicellular plant cells. Now why this debate should come up? Okay, what is the basis behind this debate? Is maybe you can tell me what is the basic difference between the animals and plants? Can you tell me this? Yes, anyone? What is the basic difference? If I ask you to differentiate between animals and plants, what are the points that you can enlist? Yes, quickly. This is school level, isn't it? Anybody would know this? Yes. You can unmute and speak. Each one can give me one point. Yes.
Hello, ma'am. No?
Yes, tell me.
Plants mein animal cell cell wall hota hai aur
right. Animals right. Complete your statement. Yes. So plant cells have cell wall which is missing in animal cells. Animal cells are without cell wall, but there is cell membrane present. Okay. What else?
Ma'am, the life process is yes. Default.
Okay. You said that cell wall is absent in animal cells. Then you said that life processes differ. Okay. Agree. Somebody else was also speaking.
Vacuoles are functional in plant cells.
And vacuoles. Not so much. Okay. Then not so much is a very relative term.
No, sir.
Okay. Yes, Damini.
Ma'am, they are not motile and they yes. produce their own food, whereas animals cannot yes. produce their own food.
Yes. So I am looking for a very basic difference. So maybe you can say non-motile and motile. So which is not very true. Or which is not a very strict difference, okay, because there are many animals which are totally non-motile, okay, they spend whole
there
life yes so there are some major families, major orders which are totally non-motile, okay, but yes, if you just broadly if you can see around, yes, the plants are non-motile and animals are, they can move. Okay, that is one difference. The other difference that you said is more important, that the animals are heterotrophic. They do not prepare their own food. On the other hand, plants are autotrophic. They can make their own food because they have chlorophyll pigment. So that is the basic difference if we can see. But still there are some exceptions. Like there are some unicellular eukaryotic organisms which are having chlorophyll, they prepare their own food, they are autotrophic, and hence there is a debate that whether these should come under animals or they should come under plants. So therefore the protozoans are considered as kingdom protista. Okay, instead of considering it as a phylum protozoa, it is a big group. It has got a lot of diversity, it has got many species. And of course, there is a debate whether it is plant cell or animal cell, because some of them are heterotrophic, some of them are autotrophic, some of them are chemotrophic. Okay, and hence they are put together in a different group, that is a different kingdom. So like kingdom Plantae, kingdom Animalia, there is kingdom Protista. So the whole kingdom is later further divided into different phyla. And there are so many phyla, around 20-22 phyla that are present in the kingdom Protista. Again, how many phyla and why kingdom Protista or phylum protozoa, it is again a debate, and the recent classification scheme says that it is kingdom Protista. Okay, but we are going to study protozoa, that is the phylum protozoa, as a part of animal kingdom. Now why we are doing so, why we are ignoring the latest updates in the classification system, because we are more interested in understanding the concepts, okay, the basis of classification, rather than understanding the facts of each and every organism and where it belongs. Okay, so to begin with, it is easier to understand the protozoa as phylum. So these unicellular eukaryotic organisms as a phylum, and once we understand them as a phylum and how they can be divided into classes, then we can maybe shift our focus, if interested, to studying protozoa as a kingdom Protista. Okay, so because we are more interested in making the concepts right now rather than remembering the facts, we will consider this as a phylum protozoa. Okay, and not consider, there are many schemes which consider the phylum, which consider these eukaryotic unicellular organisms under phylum protozoa. Okay, the classical schemes, the old schemes. Okay, so that is why we will call it a phylum protozoa, and then we will study the characteristic features of this class and then how it is classified. Okay, and then if interested, one can always study it as kingdom Protista. Okay, so here basically they are trying to show how these Protista, there it is different from the other kingdoms of Animalia. So these also are, maybe this could be very unfamiliar names, which are very much primitive phyla of Animalia, or they are, and they are, these are the primitive phyla, and these are then broadly divided groups. So these are not even phyla. Okay, so you can call it maybe subkingdom. So, but if you talk, if we talk about Protista, then of course there are some like Giardia, which are parasitic. Then this is the common, most familiar amoeba. These are foraminiferans, which have shells present around them. And these are dinoflagellates. Okay, so these are the different groups that belong to the kingdom Protista. But let us study first the characteristics of these animals, and then understand whether to put them in the kingdom Protista or then classify them under the kingdom Animalia as phylum Protozoa. Okay, so these are the characteristics that we are going to discuss in further. This is a we can say a drawing, okay, which is being made to describe a typical structure of a protozoa. Okay, so it will not have all the characteristics, but generally how a protozoan cell would look like, it will have all the cell organelles which are present in a typical cell. So here they have shown flagellum as a locomotory organ, but in some protozoa, instead of flagellum, there are many cilia present. In some case, instead of cilia or flagellum or flagella, there are pseudopodia present. Okay, so of course this is a typical drawing, okay, which is, which could be common for most of the protozoans. So there are contractile vacuoles for the excretion, then there are mitochondria for producing ATP, then there is a nucleus which is going to take care of transcription, then translation. So there is endoplasmic reticulum, the Golgi body, which will take care of packaging of the proteins. So like any typical cell, all the cell organelles are going to be there in these protozoan species. Okay, so let us consider now all these characteristics, okay, one by one. Okay, so basically what do you mean by unicellularity? So there is one particular cell that is doing all the function. This we have also studied in the grades of organization. So unicellular organisms would not show division of labor, and all the functions will be done by the single cell. Okay, so of course there will be no specialization for a particular function, but the cell is there to, and it has to perform all the functions which are required for survival. For example, respiration, then the, of course, thermoregulation, it can be osmoregulation, it can be reproduction, then circulation, or or maybe the sensory or nervous system, nervous coordination. So it can be at a very primary level, okay, very basic level, but the work is done, okay, the purpose is served. So some mechanism is there in that cell which is going to take care of all these functions. So even if there is no specialization, no systems, no tissue, that is a single cell, but it is self-sufficient, okay. So, but there are different cell organelles present for different work, okay. And sometimes there is one nucleus, sometimes there are two nuclei, sometimes there are multiple nuclei. So it also depends on what species of protozoa it is. Some like amoeba would have one nucleus, some like paramecium would have two nuclei, like micronucleus and macronucleus. And there are some which have many nuclei, which are known as multinucleated protozoan. So it again depends on the species. So this is a type of variation that we can see in this particular group. So what is the morphology? That means how a typical protozoa would look like. If you come across a protozoa, would you be able to identify it? So the size of the protozoa is very small. Naturally, it is a single cell and cells are small, right? So largest protozoa can be around 150 μm in diameter and smallest can be 1 micrometer in the diameter. So it could be as is, the size varies from 1 to 150 times of the smallest one. So you can say if you want to compare it from any familiar example, then you can say maybe some protozoa like giant amoeba, okay, it can grow up to 1 millimeter. So if you come across this, you may not be able to identify it unless and until you know that this particular organism is present on the slide, okay, then maybe you can see it from your naked eyes. Some exceptional cases which are slightly larger and can be seen with naked eyes. But otherwise, all the protozoa are microscopic and they have to be observed under microscope. It can be 10x power or 45x or even sometimes oil immersion, 100x could be required. And that is only if you want to locate the animal. If you want to see inside what are the cell organelles, then of course you will require more magnification. The shapes are generally round, oval, bell-shaped, slipper-shaped, or sometimes they are present inside the shell. So, of course, the shape of the shell becomes the shape of the animal. So, again, the shape can be variable. It can be varying. So, from species to species, from individual to individual, sometimes, for example, in amoeba, there is no shape, because it moves through pseudopodia, and pseudopodia are what? They are cytoplasmic extension. So the cytoplasm moves in any direction and hence the shape of the amoeba also changes. So it will vary from individual to individual. It would also vary in the same individual at different time. No. So there is no rule about shape. The color is generally clear. Okay. The protozoans are not very colorful. They are clear, they are transparent. But then you would say that just now we saw a few which were green. Here maybe there is something again greenish. Here it is pinkish. So what is this green? This is the chlorophyll pigment. So it is the chlorophyll pigment which is giving the color to the cell. Otherwise, it is not a color. There is no other coloring pigment inside the cell. It is not opaque. It is transparent. Sometimes the color, for example, here the color is due to ingested food. So if the protozoa has eaten something, that color, if it is purple in color, the protozoa would look purple. If it is neon pink, then the protozoa would look neon pink. But to observe this particular organism, we must stain them before we observe them. Otherwise, it will be very difficult because they are transparent. We can see through. We can see the inside organelles. Talking about symmetry, now you know what does the symmetry mean, right? So we have studied that in the last lecture. So if you look at the examples of these protozoa, then of course they show different types of symmetry. So here this is asymmetrical, and if this is spherical, then you can call it the radial symmetry. Maybe you can get radial symmetry if the axis passes from the center. Here maybe you can get bilateral symmetry. So again, in different species, in different classes of protozoa, there can be different type of symmetry. So because there is so much variation in the phylum protozoa, this symmetry also varies. So you can see here how transparent the cell is. Okay, if it is not stained, it is very difficult to identify. Now let us understand how the exoskeleton is there and endoskeleton is made up of in this particular animals. Now sometimes we may wonder that, or we just keep calling protozoans as primitive, single cell and no specialization. So we may assume that there is also no exoskeleton present. Okay, but on the contrary, the kingdom Protista, or let us say the phylum protozoa, they show variation in the type of exoskeleton. They show different type of exoskeleton, and looking at the type of the covering, the type of the envelope that is present, we can identify the species of this protozoa. So the simplest type of exoskeleton or the envelope that could be present is plasma lemma, which is just a membrane which is flexible, but it is selectively permeable. Then thicker than plasma lemma is pellicle, which is common in paramecium. But again, it gives some kind of flexibility. It is not very rigid. Now, lorica is something which is rigid than the pellicle. So it is made up of plates. These plates are generally secreted by the cells. So these are the plates which are made up of either calcium carbonate, but most of the times they are made up of silica. And these siliceous plates, they form cover around the cell. So plates are joined together with a cementing material. Again, that is also secreted by the cell. Now imagine the cell is not specialized. The cell is doing all the other function. At the same time, it is also secreting the covering or the envelope, which is going to protect that particular cell in the during the unfavorable conditions. So this is called lorica. So here, see, you can easily see that it is made up of different plates. This is one plate. This is the second one. See the third one. And these plates are jointed together. So these are the loricae, okay? And inside the organism is present. And of course, there are going to be small openings through which the cilia or flagella can come out. So see, the envelope is not going to be closed totally. There has to be access to outside environment for food, for oxygen, for excretion. So of course, there are openings, through which the organelles, the organelles which are required for the movement, okay, locomotion, they can be emerged. This you can see, look, it may look similar to some mollusk, isn't it? A snail. But these are not the shells of any snail. These are not shells of any mollusk. These are shells of foraminiferans, which are also protozoans. Okay, so single cell animal which float in the water. They are aquatic and they form this shell again by the secretion of the cell, or they are sometimes made up of some material which is present around in the ecosystem. So there can be small particles of shells of other animals. There can be small sand particles. There can be some small bone particles that are present. So you can imagine how small the particles would be, because they are going to be cemented together to form covering of a single cell. So, and then if you can see the structure and the pattern and the design which is there on the shell is very specific to particular species. So looking at the way this particular shell has been formed, looking at this, we can identify that which type of species it is. So the common one in case of the shell or the foraminiferan is Elphidium. So this one is Elphidium. Okay. Then the next is cyst. Now cyst is also a particular phase in the life cycle. Okay. So cyst is sometimes formed as a part of the reproduction, and these are the gametes which are covered together with a thick membrane of proteinaceous material, and this particular stage gets protected by the unfavorable conditions which could be there in the surrounding. And once the favorable conditions return, the cyst will break open, and from that new organisms would come out, or the next generation would come out. So cyst can also be a part of reproductive phase, which is cyst is generally observed in the protozoans which are parasitic. Okay, because parasitic protozoa need to have a phase where they are depositing their gametes, and then the gametes would survive some unfavorable condition, and then once they reach to host where they get the favorable conditions, then it will break open and then of course flourish further. Okay, so this is about the exoskeleton. What about endoskeleton? Endoskeleton is same as any typical cell. It is made up of maybe tubulin, or it can be actin filaments. So protein filaments that generally form the structure, for holding structure for any cell. Okay, it is similar to that. So locomotion, I guess you would be familiar with the pseudopodia, cilia and flagella, these terms. Pseudopodia are cytoplasmic extension, cilia and flagella are special. They show 9+2 tubular arrangement. That means cilia or flagella, if you just cut, okay, and then you see through it like a pipe. So if you see through, you can see 9+2. That means 9 tubules at the periphery and 2 tubules at the center. So this one cilia or one flagellum, one cilium or one flagellum show 9+2, that means total 11 tubules. So they are bundles of even finer tubules. And if we talk about cilia and flagella, if we compare them, then cilia are always shorter and flagella are always longer. On the other hand, cilia are numerous, they are many, and flagella are few. So they can be 1, there can be 2, there can be 3, maximum there could be 10. Okay, but generally they are fewer than cilia. Cilia you cannot count. They are present all over. They are in thousands maybe. Also, cilia can be present all over, or they are restricted to one particular area. But that area is not as small or as we can say limited as compared to the flagella. Okay, so see here, if you can see, there are two types of cytoplasm. One is the thin cytoplasm, and the other is a thick cytoplasm. So thin cytoplasm and thick cytoplasm move in sync with each other, and that is how the movement of movement of amoeba takes place, and it is explained by Sol Jale theory. Okay, so if you are interested, you can read about Sol Jale theory. And cilia and flagella move by beating, okay, because there are tubules present. Okay, so it is tubules can contract and relax like our muscle fibers. Okay, and that is how the cilia and flagella help locomotion in protozoa. Now let us understand how is nutrition in protozoa. Now I have put only 4 types here, but there are more than 4. They can be further divided into many different types. There are some protozoa which are very specific to particular type of food, particular chemical through which it will obtain energy. So but broadly, if we try to classify, there are some which are autotrophic, which show presence of chlorophyll pigment. Then there are some which are heterotrophic. This now heterotrophic means what they will eat. They will eat everything which is smaller than their cell size maybe. So they will eat other protozoa, they will eat remains of other protozoan cells, or they can eat other degenerating molecules that are present in the surrounding. It could be coming from other plants, it could be some bacteria, it could be a bacterial colony. So heterotrophic amoeba can eat anything which is anything, but it will not be producing its own food because it lacks chlorophyll pigment. The other is saprophytic. Saprophytic means these protozoa, they take up the decaying matter which is present as a small molecules in the environment, that they take it up as food, and using that they produce energy. Now these molecules are already slightly digested. The degenerating or decaying food which is or decaying molecules which are present in the surrounding, that can be used by saprophytic protozoa. So most flagellates are saprophytic. So there are some which are parasitic. Now, what do you mean by parasitic? They are depending on another host. They are totally dependent on the host for the food. they may not, sometimes they are also dependent on the host for reproduction, for oxygen, for respiration, okay? But most of the times the protozoans which are dependent on the host for food, they are known as parasitic protozoa, and the examples can be Plasmodium, Giardia. So Plasmodium is the common one, you would be able to remember it very easily. It is a malarian parasite. So the next point is reproduction. How these unicellular, primitive, eukaryotic animals, or sometimes debated as plant cells, how they reproduce. So of course they have survived this whole course of evolution. They are there on earth even before humans or any higher animals were there, no? So they are the old, they could be the oldest, and till now they have survived. That means they must be having very good reproductive mechanism. So they, and the secret of this survival could be, they are not depending on only one type of, of course they have survived. That means what? They have a good reproductive mechanism. And how their reproductive mechanism is, it is of multiple types. So if one thing doesn't work, there is some alternative to it. And then it is seen that the race continues, okay? So what are these different modes of reproduction? The one is asexual and the other is sexual. So asexual mode is quite dominating, very well developed, and there are different types of asexual reproduction. There can be budding, binary fission, multiple fission, reduction bodies or cyst formation, sometimes fragmentation, sometimes what we can say, the plasmotomy, where at a time many cells are formed, which is slightly similar to multiple fission. So these are the different types of asexual modes of reproduction in protozoa. But there are also sexual modes. There is also gamete formation. There is another mode of reproduction that is sexual, is conjugation, where the exchange of nuclear material takes place with the help of a formation of a cytoplasmic bridge. And then it is considered as sexual reproduction. And I have not written here, but of course gamete formation also happens in case of protozoans. Okay, there is gamete formation. Sometimes the nucleus is considered as gamete. Sometimes the whole cell is considered as gamete, because it forms haploid cells and then it gets fused with other haploid cells. So fertilization can happen. So there are mechanisms which are comparable to gamete formation, comparable to fertilization, comparable to zygote formation. And hence we can say that of course the protozoa can show sexual reproduction. And that could be the reason. So every time particular species cannot keep multiplying by asexual reproduction. Why? Because asexual reproduction gives rise to same or similar, or maybe we can say the progeny is alike, exactly similar to each other genetically. So if there is some environmental condition or environmental pressure which is going to select some individual, okay, for evolution, for survival, then in that case, if all are same, either all will die or all will survive, no? So the survival of the race, the chances of survival are less. So therefore, after a particular cycles of asexual reproduction, every species of protozoa would multiply sexually to restore the variation in the population. I hope you are getting me, what do I mean by variation and selection, okay? So there are, so this is example of binary fission, and these are different types of binary fission. This is longitudinal binary fission. See, this is a longitudinal axis. So the cell has divided into two. So initially there was one flagellum. So first flagellum became double, then the organelles became double. So here nucleus was one, here the nucleoli became double, then there is division started. So this is basically longitudinal division. This is transverse division. Okay, so there are, the fission can be two types, binary and multiple. And binary fission can be further, maybe two or three types, longitudinal, transverse and oblique, depending on through which plane the division is happening. So all these are the types of reproduction that are seen in protozoa. Budding is formation of a small bud which then gets detached and then gives rise to young one, and then of course that will develop into adult. Then multiple fission is one cell giving rise to many cells at a time. Reduction body is formation of dormant bodies which can pass unfavorable condition and then again become active once the favorable conditions come up. Reduction body is also common in porifera. It is less common in protozoa. And cyst formation we have already discussed. Okay. So what did we study? We saw level of organization of protozoa, that is unicellularity, single cell doing all the functions. We saw size, shape, color and symmetry in protozoa. We studied about exoskeleton, its types, then different types of locomotion, pseudopodia, cilia, flagella, types of nutrition, then reproduction. And what about respiration? How respiration takes place in protozoa? It is by simple diffusion. So gas enters into the cell, and whatever percentage is oxygen that will be utilized by the cell to produce ATP, and the carbon dioxide which has been produced will again diffuse out through the cytoplasmic membrane. So there is no special feature, there is no special mechanism for the respiration. It is just diffusion, simple diffusion from the simple diffusion through the cell membrane. Okay, so I hope it is clear to you. Anything that you want to ask?